am going to talk today about finances. It's not going to be easy. I've never been one to talk about money problems, and I've been having a lot of them. So I'm going to go back to the beginning. So hopefully you can avoid this. I was actually doing fairly well. I have a decent job. I bring home enough money that I was socking a little bit away in a savings account. I had saved enough money that I had planned to move out of the studio apartment I'm in and find a one-bedroom apartment that I would have just, I would feel more like a grown-up. I'm 56 years old. I was 54, 55 when I was planning this and thinking, I'm too old for a studio apartment. Even though I'm alone, I need that private space of my bedroom. I need to be able to shut that bedroom door. I need to have a place where I can have friends over and not have them see the bed sitting there. Have a comfortable sitting area, a living room, have an actual kitchen. I don't have a kitchen. I have a refrigerator and a microwave. So I don't cook at all, and I haven't since 2012. So that's just too long. It's time to get into a real apartment. So I had these plans. I had enough money saved. I had a down payment. I could actually hire somebody off Craigslist to move me. I didn't have to do that myself. And then when I got the cancer diagnosis, I had planned this last summer. It was like, okay, the first of the year, I'm going to do all of this. That was my plan. I'll save a few hundred dollars more, and that was my goal. And then I got the cancer diagnosis in July, and that just blew up everything. I didn't really think about the cost, the financial aspect of it at the time. And then when it came time for the surgery, the lumpectomy, I had to fly my daughter and my grandson over here at the last minute, so flight was not cheap. And I tried to get some assistance for that since it was medical related, but since I wasn't flying for medical care, I couldn't find anybody to help. And so I ended up covering the whole thing. That's what threw all my credit cards out of whack. I had to charge everything. And, before that I was charging a little, paying it off. I was doing really good on my credit. And so that, when I flew them out here, I maxed out all my credit cards, and then, sorry, this is really difficult to talk about. I don't have notes. I'm just winging this one, like I ever really have notes. But then while she was here, of course, there's eating out and there's going to see different tourist things, some of which we tried to do everything on the really cheap. But there are some things that do, we had to go to Pearl Harbor. My father was at Pearl Harbor, December 7, 1941, he was there. And so obviously he survived because I'm here, but we had to go do that, And so there are some things that do cost money. And we did those, but there was a lot of eating out because I don't have a kitchen, and You know, and it was rough, the three of us in the studio apartment. That was not easy as well. You know, it would be nice to have a place where I can have somebody from the mainland come over and stay and have a place to put them. Anyway, so so my credit cards got maxed out. And then after that, you know, I was paying them down. I was keeping up with my payments. I felt like I was never going to get on top of them at that point, though, because they were completely maxed out, and all I could really afford was the minimum payments on them. I was trying to pay a little bit more to get the, what do you call it, the base down. But then I started getting hit with the medical bills, and that's when everything really spiraled. I do have insurance. I'm with Kaiser, but it's still only, you know, the 80-20 or whatever it is, the 80-20, and not everything is covered. And for surgery, that, you know, that 20% is whopping. And so I was having to pay that, you know, and on, this is on top of student loan, on top of car loan, car insurance, rent, and then just all the regular stuff you have to, you know, gas and food and, you know, all the other stuff that you have to do normally. And so once the medical bills started coming in and I wanted to stay on top of those, then the credit cards started slipping a little bit. And then I'd go back to the credit cards and the medical bills would slip, and I'd go back to the and it would go back and forth. And then I got sent for radiation. Radiation was outsourced. So it was not covered quite the same. Be careful of that. I was sent to the Cancer Institute of Hawaii, which is part of the Cancer Institute of America or whatever it is. You see the commercials for them on TV all the time. Be very careful. I cannot believe how much the radiation costs. It is exorbitant. And I mean, I don't have the figures in front of me, but it was extremely high. And, you know, I mean, we're talking a couple hundred dollars a session, and you have to go every day. So look at everything, ask questions about the finances. But I was in such a fog and didn't have anybody standing here helping me think through things, and so I just didn't get to that point where I thought about things like that until it was too late. And so by time the radiation bills started coming in, I was just over my head. And that's when the credit card bills went off the radar, and I wasn't able to pay them for a couple of months. And so then I did contact the credit card companies, asked if there was some sort of hardship program, explained my circumstances with the cancer, which is very hard to do over the phone to a stranger. You know, you'd think it would be a little bit easier, but it's not. I'm a very private person. It took me a long time before I even told anybody about the cancer. I mean, I told the people closest to me, but like people at work, I didn't tell. It wasn't until my hair was gone that, you know, I figure, okay, people are guessing about it and they think either I'm doing drugs or I'm sick. So I had to kind of start talking about it a little bit. And then as I started doing these, it's gotten a little bit easier to talk about that. So maybe it'll be easier for me to talk about finances if I start talking about them in a venue like this. But I went to the credit card companies and I asked, you know, to get if there was some sort of hardship program due to my circumstances. Most of them were very nice and understanding. As I previously reported in one of my videos, there was one that said, okay, we'll help you, but we're going to close your credit card. And they said, when you're done paying, we'll close your card. And I asked, what if I pay it off early? And they said, we'll close your credit card. And when I made the first payment, they closed the credit card. They didn't even wait for me to finish paying. They just closed it. And considering it's a major bank, and I have no qualms about saying it's Citibank, it was my Costco Visa card. I thought that was rather rude and heartless, considering they are a major bank and they, you know, I'm not trying to get one over on them. I said, I want to pay this. I want to be honest and I don't want to let this go to where you're having to sue me for the money. I want to make it good. And they still treated me like a piece of trash. And so, you know, that's my take on it is like, you know, I get this disease that I have no control over. I didn't ask for it. I didn't do anything that caused this disease. And this is how you treat your customers. So, sorry. So I've been, you know, I've made like, I think there's only been like 1 month of payments on the credit cards now. I still cannot charge anything on them because until they're paid off, the cards are essentially dead cards. I mean, you know, they're like on hold. I can't do anything. All the other cards will be good once I pay them down. This gets harder and harder. A few weeks ago, Tucker started having problems with his hind legs. He has a history of degenerative disc disease, which is when the discs in the spine, two of the discs kind of fuse together, and so it gives them problems. And that was about 8 years ago, eight years ago, I guess. And he's been fine with it. You know, we went through the original treatment and where he just couldn't be outside. He had to be an indoor dog. He had to be kenneled for 6 months. It was miserable. But the alternative was surgery at that time. And we didn't want to do that, or I didn't want to do that. I just felt that that was too extreme. And so I did the kenneling. But since then, he's been fine. If he gets too active, if he goes climbing over the rocks like he likes to do, and he's too aggressive with it, if we go on a long walk, and we're on hilly and up and down and he's running around, you know, chasing the smells like he likes to do. Or if we go to the dog park and he gets into chasing with the other dogs and running around, it can bother him like that night. But once he rests for a day or two, then he's fine again. And it never actually put him down, but it started to really bother him a few weeks ago, and I guess it's been close to a month now, and it was to the point where he could not use his back legs at all, and he was, if he tried to move, he was just dragging them. So I took him to the vet, and the vet thinks he also, in addition to the degenerative disc disease, he thinks there's some arthritis in the back legs. At the same time, he found that Tucker has some rotting teeth, which makes me feel like crap. Tucker would never let me brush his teeth, so I didn't. You know, I figured, I don't know, I've had dogs before and I've never had to brush their teeth and they always do fine. But for some reason, you know, Tucker got the rotting teeth, so please brush your dog's teeth. Do it yourself, train them when they're young to take the toothbrush or the finger pad and take them to the vet once a year and have them do a thorough cleaning. If I've learned anything from this, that's one thing I've learned. So, in a few days, Tucker has to undergo surgery and have those teeth removed. At the same time, he's going to have x-rays on his hind, on his legs and his back end. I opted to wait and to have the x-rays done while he's having the surgery because for where he's has the problems and where they need the x-rays done, he would have to be anesthetized and I didn't want to have him go through that twice. So once we have the x-rays back and they can see where the problems are exactly, he can start laser treatments. Another expense. The surgery is close to $1,200 with the x-rays. The laser treatments are going to be, I think she said $30 or $40 a treatment, depending on where they are and how long the treatment lasts. And he'll probably go once or twice a week. So you can see how my finances are looking now. I also have to have my car, we have this thing in Hawaii called a safety inspection. You have to take your car in once a year and go through this. Has nothing to do with emissions or smog, nothing like that. All they do is they look at all the safety features of the car and make sure that everything is operating okay. You know, they test the windshield wipers and the blinkers and the brakes and just all the safety features. And the inspection itself is about $25, $26. And it's due next month. But I have had a gauge light on for tire pressure that I cannot get to go off. All the tires are aired up, including the spare. I've done all the tricks. I've researched the hell out of this one. I've done all the tricks that I can find on the internet and nothing works. And I think there must be a dead battery in one of the sensors. Because the car is about 10 years old. And so it's very possible that there's just a dead battery. And so I'm probably looking at about $200 just to have that checked before I go for the safety inspection. Because if you go to a safety inspection with a gauge light on, you're automatically denied. And then you have to go get it fixed and then take it back for another safety inspection that you have to pay for again. So I just want to get it fixed before I go. So I have to have that done this month before I go for the safety inspection next month. And then, you know, on top of this, there's more. I have had this swelling issue in my breast, which I've been making videos about, and I just did another one that posted this morning about the results of what this swelling is. It's something called lymphedema. And what happens is when they take the lymph node out, the fluid for the lymph node has to go somewhere. Usually it goes into the arm and you have problems with your arm swelling. For me, it's going into the breast for some reason, and I'm like that 0.011 or something that gets that, and it's very uncommon. And I mean, it's taken a month or more. How long has it been? It's been at least a month, probably longer, that I've been after my doctors about this. You know, why is this happening? What's going on? And my breast has, when I first started asking my doctors about this, my breast was just a little bit larger. You know, my right breast was just a little bit larger than my left breast. Now it's about 3 cup sizes larger. So it's growing. Even from just like a week and a half ago, it's growing. So my doctor is now telling me it may never go down. The likelihood is that it will never go down. You will live with this. And what makes me mad is that nowhere in my pre-surgical information was there anything about lymphedema. None of my notes, doctors never said anything about it, that it was a possibility, it was a possible side effect, nothing. So I have to now go through, I have to go to an occupational therapist to see if there's anything that they can suggest, compression of any kind, except it's in the breast, so there's not really a place to compress. When it's in the arm, you can wear a compression sleeve. You can do exercises. How do you exercise a breast? So I'll have costs for those, more medical costs. Just as I thought all my medical care was going down, it's going to start going back up again. I will have to have a prosthetic for the other breast to make it the same size because I'm so lopsided. I will have to get special bras. It's like the costs just keep coming and coming and I can't get around them. So a friend of mine a couple of weeks ago suggested that I start a GoFundMe page, which I did, and I've got the link down below. I'm not out here begging for money. Why I'm doing this is if you are just being diagnosed with cancer, look at your finances. Think about what's going to happen, not only in the next couple of months, but over the next couple of years. You know, do you have $20,000 or $30,000 in savings that can cushion this? Because your $3,000 in savings is not going to do it. And if you're living paycheck to paycheck like I do, you're gonna be screwed. You have to take care of that. You have to start right away. Because otherwise you are going to sink fast. And that is my main, you know, that's what I need to get across. You have to look at everything. You have to ask, how much is this going to cost? What are, you know, go to the financial offices at your provider and say, how much is this going to cost me? How much is this going to cost me? Is insurance going to cover what portion of this? If you're going to send me for outside referral, you know, you contact the insurance company and say, what is the coverage on that? And then go to the other referred provider and say, what is going to be the cost of this? You have to check everything. Because I didn't do that and I am so, so screwed right now. Quite honestly, I may be living in my car next month. I don't know. You know, I've got Tucker's surgery in just a few days, and I've got nothing. And I can't put it off because I don't want his teeth to get infected and cause more problems. And so I've got to take my car payment, my student loan, my groceries, the money I would spend on groceries, the money I would spend on all my credit card payments, which I've just made, you know, deals with the banks that I would make these payments on time. And I've got to put everything on that vet bill. And so I'm screwing everybody else that I promised I would pay. And I don't know how to deal with it. So I know I try to keep all my videos really upbeat and, you know, lifting, and I try to be cheery and happy, and I'm at a point right now though, I am so stressed out over, you know, Tucker and my own medical issues with the lymphedema and all the financial pressures. I cannot do uplifting videos right now. There's still one that has to air that's a little bit more lighthearted, but, and it keeps getting pushed out because all this other stuff is happening, so I just keep pushing it back. It's really hard to film in here when you have windows that go around the whole place and you see what's going on. And you just want to be anywhere but here, anywhere but in your own body. And things are not always going to be as easy as you want them to be. You know, I try to put up a good front, and I can't always do it. I'm just at a point now where I'm not sure how much longer I can hang in, and, you know, financially, emotionally, so this is why I'm telling you, when you are very first diagnosed, take a look at your finances, talk to all of your providers, your insurance company, you know, take careful stock of what you have on hand and what you can handle. And I'm not saying don't have treatments, but I'm saying plan it. Don't push it aside, don't ignore it, thinking that you just have to do what you have to do and it'll all work out, because it's not all working out. And anyway, so if you have questions or if there's something else you'd like me to cover, comment down below. Please like the video, because that may help me get to my subscriber limit for monetization. I feel like that's gonna happen. You know, please, if you haven't subscribed, hit the subscribe button and the little notification bell that's down wherever it is. And I will talk to you later, and hopefully be in a better mood.